In such way. Please let me know if you could see my screen and I started to present.
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Okay. Sure. Awesome. So today we will talk about the Operator Lifecycle Manager for Kubernetes. So I'll tell you about the way how you can manage the continuous delivery for your operators to the Kubernetes cluster. So this session will be split for four parts. So we'll talk about the operator framework, understand what is that, the same for the Operator SDK, Operator Lifecycle Manager, and like traditionally at the end of this call, we will have the usage demo. So I will demonstrate everything that we will discuss during this call, like practically, and you will see how it works and you'll be able to reproduce it like by yourself. So the first topic, it's the operator framework. So let's try to remind to ourselves, what is the Kubernetes operator pattern? What actually the operator framework, because there are a lot of misunderstanding with these definitions, and I'll explain you why it happens. And also we will talk about the operator framework's components. So let's, as I mentioned, let's try to remind what is actually the Kubernetes operator pattern. So it's a well-known pattern. It's not something related to OLM or operator framework. It's a common pattern that describes how you can manage your Kubernetes application in a native way. Like in the Kubernetes, you have a deployments, replica set, daemon sets, and et cetera. And you have a controllers in the, like embedded controllers that control the state of those resources. So the Kubernetes allows you to like extend its possibilities, and like you can manage your resources in such way. So you can store the information about your resources in a custom resource definitions and like use it with a custom controller to make some kind of actions and etc. So if you will take a look on this simple schema, so we have a controller, we have for example the custom resource, and the controller will watch and compare the custom resource and will check in how the state like is presented in the cluster, and if something will be need to be done, so it will execute the recon selections and will prepare everything and move it to the desired state. So if you are familiar with the like configuration management systems like Puppet, Chef, and etc., so it's a configuration management system that use the pool model. Yeah, so it works in the same way. Yeah, the information about your resource will be stored in the Kubernetes etcd, and your controller will examine it through the Kubernetes API. Take this information, do some actions, and like we'll do some, like we'll orchestrate your system, like orchestrate your Kubernetes environment to the like to your desired state. So this actually we are good with that. So there are a lot of tools that will help you to like organize like your code, logic, and you can, like all of them are written on different programming languages. So it means also that you can like write the like implement it, for example, with a bash script or PowerShell script. So it doesn't matter. However, the tools will help you to do that in the easier way without writing all the unnecessary code, and like will save your time and will speed up the development of your operator. So, and one of them, it's the operator framework. And actually, we will talk about it during our call, because it's the most familiar framework to build the operator. And for example, if you are also familiar with the Red Hat products, such as OpenShift. So for example, if you want to publish your application or your service to the Red Hat marketplace and earn the money, so you need to prepare everything in the operator view, and also you need to like certify your operator. And to be certified, it should be written, like it should be developed with the Operator Framework SDK. Before we actually start, we need to understand the difference between three definitions. So, because as I mentioned, there are a lot of misunderstanding. We have the operator framework, we have the operator SDK, and we have the operator lifecycle manager. So the operator framework, it's like the common definition. So the operator SDK and operator lifecycle manager, it's a part of the operator framework. So the operator SDK allows you ability to build your operators, and the operator lifecycle manager gives you ability like to manage your operators. But about the main pillars for those products, we'll talk on the next slides. Okay, so what's actually the operator framework? So operator frameworks, as I mentioned, it's a common definition. So it consists from the SDK and the managed application, like OLM. And it will give you ability to build, manage, and like discover your applications, because it's also the way how you can distribute your applications. That's all about the operator framework, because like it's a common definition, so there is nothing to say more. Now let's talk about the main components of it, and here we will have like more details. So operator SDK, as I mentioned, it's a tool that like it's a not just a tool, maybe it's the SDK. However, it's distributed as one simple tool. However, it contains all functional that you need to develop your operators, make a test, and prepare it for distribution. So it will allow you to build, test, and iterate. So the build and test, it's okay, but what actually means by iterate? So the operator SDK and actually operator framework idea allows you to have some kind of splitting for your operator versions, and will allow you to implement some kind of release strategy for them. We will talk about the upgrade strategies and etc. mostly at the end of our call. So it's just one simple tool that contains a lot of subcommands that will allow you to, for example, generate the layout for your future operator. In the easiest way, generate the templates for your API, for your custom resources, for the controllers, build the images for all that things, and etc. So if you are familiar with the operator stuff, so it will be easy for you. But if you not, then what you will be need to do after this call, just try to read something about the operator patterns and operator SDK, and just try to look on this video one more time. How the SDK actually works? So you have some kind of idea, what your operator should do, which kind of resources you want to manage by the operator, and etc. So you develop the main API, you develop the controller for that, you make the local test. So after you make the local test, you will do the test on your, for example, local cluster like Minikube, and etc. And then you publish all your artifacts. So it's all the steps that are related to the, for example, CI part of your workflow. So the artifacts will, as an artifact, you will have two items. The first one, it's an operator manifest. And the second one, it's the operator image. Probably you might have some additional artifacts. For example, if you manage some kind of applications with your operator, you will also have the images that will be related to your application. However, it's not the part of the operator. So the operator consists just from the manifest and the image. So the image contains the logic for the controller that you built and will be deployed in your cluster and will watch and compare your custom resources. And the operator manifest, it's the document, it's a standard, it's designed as a Kubernetes custom resource. It contains the information about the way how the how your operator must be deployed to your application and which custom resources like related to your operator and will be managed by your operator. Also, it probably contains some kind of additional metadata. However, like again, we will talk about this like when we will talk about the cluster service version document. Yeah, but I'll give you like more detailed, maybe if it will be duplicated twice, so then we will have like better result. So you can like with the operator SDK, you can develop your operators in three ways. So you can build it in a native way with a Golang, because operator SDK is the Golang based framework. You can build it with Ansible and you can build it with a Helm. So the last way, it's like the easiest when you, for example, you have all your services application.
So like it seems Eldar has some issues with the internet connection. Let's wait a few minutes for him to freeze out.
Oh yeah, then let's continue. Okay, so as I mentioned, like if you have a Helm chart, then you can like take your Helm chart and convert it to operator. So the migration way in this case will be like the easiest. The second easiest way, Ansible. So you can like write your reconcile logic and controllers based on the Ansible playbooks. However, this way is limited, and you'll see like when we will check the operator capability levels on the next slide, you will see why it's limited. And like the main way that is actually recommended by the authors of the Operator SDK, it's a Go-based way. So it allows you to write some kind of custom logic. So you have like unlimited possibilities how you can implement your operator and which logic you can add to your operator. So it's a preferred way. And for example, if you are not familiar with that, no worries, because in Golang, it's a pretty simple language. And for writing of the operators, you don't need to know like some, you don't need to have a, like a deep knowledge of the Golang. Just for example, you need to understand how the typization work and like how the structures in the Golang looks like. So usually like the workflow to build operator is the like simple. You install the operator SDK utility to your system, then you generate the project layout, then you add some kind of new API that will be presented to the custom resources in the Kubernetes, then you define the controllers. However, like this step probably will be omitted because during the generation of the API, you can pass the some additional flag that will allow you to create the controllers automatically. Then you will need to fill in the reconcile logic. So write the main logic, what your controller should do. And after that, you need just to build your controller, pack it to the Docker image and like generate the operator manifest. But all this functionality and shortcuts for this functionality will be included in the make file that will be generated in the scope of your project layout generation. So everything will be pretty straightforward. The same for the Ansible and the same for the Helm. However, like you don't need to write the Go code and like you don't need to do some additional steps to do that. And probably with the Helm stuff, you are not able to use the logic for the custom resources. So you cannot generate the custom API. Let's take a look on the operator capability level. So it's based on the like information from the previous slide. So we have five capability levels like that you can implement with your operator. So the first one is a basic upgrade, basic install. So it allows you, for example, when you start like your operator, it will allow you to create some kind of native resources or do some kind of actions. The seamless upgrade allows like the operator to watch for the custom, for the specific like patch and upgrades and perform the like the versions upgrade and probably versions upgrade automation. The third one, it's a full life cycle. So it's when you include some additional logic, some additional automation logic to your operator. For example, you include the logic for your operator that will like allow you to create, for example, the backup of the database for your application. Or for example, if it will like allow to make the automatic restart in case of the failure or something like that. The fourth level, it's pretty straightforward. It's the level that, like, when you include them, like, for example, metrics and logs collection to your application scope of the operator. In that case, like, you achieve the level four. And the fifth level, it's the autopilot level. Probably not too much public operators like develop this level, or it includes, for example, the horizontal and vertical autoscaling. So if your application, like based on the deep insights, your application knows how to like scale itself, like your operator knows how to scale your application. So in that case, it means that you have the autopilot. So probably in this case, when you like developed your operator and you started to use it, so probably you don't need any kind of manual work. So everything will be performed by your operator, and all cases for the maintenance will be described by your operator. And as I mentioned, like Helm, for example, have the limited possibilities. Yeah, it allows you to perform the basic install and, for example, the seamless upgrade. And Ansible and Go like allows you to like develop your operator and achieve all five levels. However, like in the same way, like Ansible is pretty limited by just the list of the models that Ansible have. And for example, if you need some kind of custom logic, you probably will be need to write some custom Ansible models with Python. So in both cases, you will be need to know at least one programming language for that. Yep. And the Golang, as I mentioned, it's the easiest way. So you don't need to write the embedded models. You don't need to use some kind of third-party software. So everything will be written on the Golang, will be packed, and you can use it from the box. I think that's all about the Operator SDK. And now we can talk about the Operator Lifecycle. It's the main item from our general topic. So we will understand what actually the Operator Lifecycle Manager, which features it has, like how we can configure it, and like what are the main configurations, and what are the main components of the Operator Lifecycle Manager. What actually is that? It's some kind of tool. I'll describe you why it's not actually the tool, but maybe it's a service, because you don't have, like, for example, the utility or something like that that performs by OLM. So it's a set of the services. Yeah, but let's name it like as a tool. Yeah, it's a tool that allows you like to perform the installation of your operator, do the management of your operator, and also do the upgrade of your operators like in a smart way. So usually it's presented when you like need to install it. It could be installed in two ways. Yeah, if you have the Operator SDK, so you can use it to install the OLM to your Kubernetes cluster. It's a first way. The second way, it's, for example, if you don't have the Operator SDK, and for example, in cases when you want like to use just the public operators in your cluster and you don't develop yourself operators, so you can use like the installation script from the official repo. Yeah, so the first way, just for case if you will decide like to reproduce all the practical steps. For example, if you will have the sometimes the first way could fail, yeah, and it will say that you have a timeout for that. Probably it happens when you have a slow internet connection, because this process like it will check in if everything will be deployed. And sometimes if you have the slow internet connection, you need some additional time to pull the images for the services that will be deployed in the scope of the OLM. Yeah, so no worries about that. Just make the OLM uninstall and install it again. So the images will be pulled to your, for example, Minikube or any kind of Kubernetes cluster. So and like additional deployment, it will take less time. And after that, everything will be fine. So no worries about this issue. And probably during the preparation for this session, I tested that like latest version. So you can check in today, like what is the latest version for it. Latest version works fine without any interruptions. So you can use it to make your own tests. In the same way, like we did for the Operator SDK, let's understand how it actually works. So you have the operator manifest that you prepared in the scope of like your operator development. For example, you develop like a lot of different operators, yeah, and you need to like combine all that operators in a cluster catalog. So what actually the cluster catalog? It's the same Docker image that contains like your operator manifest and allows to OLM like to get it from this catalog and allows him to install it. So as presented here, like you push your manifest to the catalog, and from the catalog it will be installed to the namespaces. What are actually the main features provided by the OLM? The first one is the over-the-air updates and catalogs. So the OLM provides you the way how you can upgrade and manage the versioning of your operators in the smart way. I'll show you more detailed view about this, as I mentioned, probably mostly at the end of this call. It's the last slides of this presentation, so no worries. Now let's leave it as is. The second one, it's a dependency model. So the OLM provides you, the strong dependency model. For example, if you need some kind of additional operators for your operator or like some kind of custom resources, for example, your operator need etcd, or your operator need to have, I don't know, the Prometheus or something like that. So you can include it as a dependency to like your operator manifest, and the OLM will install all the dependencies before installation of your operator. So you don't need to manage the installation of the dependencies by yourself manually. So this will save your time. And also you can, in easy way, you can manage the version of your dependencies. So it's a full pack dependency manager. The next one, it's discoverability. So for example, if you have your operators, nobody knows about your operator, yeah, but for example in your team or in your company you have a catalog with the operators, so you can push like your operator to that catalog, and all the users that has ability to use the OLM and your catalog, they will be able to install your application or the specific version of your application. Again, cluster stability. So for example, you have the two operators that use the same API, or maybe has some kind of conflicts with their APIs that they use. So the OLM will check in which API use your operators, and it will prevent the installation of some kind of operators that probably might corrupt your system. So it's additional item for safety of your cluster. And the last one, it's declarative UI controls. So by UI controls, they mean that like you can like configure the OLM like in the easy way, but there is no like UI or with the buttons that you can click just to install the operators. Yes, so mostly. But if you use the OpenShift platform, for example, it contains all the items and contains the UI that will allow you to install the operators. So here by the UI controls means that you can, again, with using of the custom resources, you can configure the OLM. So you can configure the OLM in the Kubernetes native way. So I'll show you how this could be performed. So the configuration of the OLM could be done with creation of the custom resources. And we have five custom resources that describe the configuration for the OLM. Each of them has its own functionality, so we will go across all of them and understand like why we need to create it and how all the that resources are interacting like with each other. Let's start with the cluster service version. So at the beginning of this call, I mentioned like the operator manifest. So the cluster service version resource, actually it's your operator manifest. So when you generate the bundle of your operator, you will have the cluster service version document. So it contains the specification section, as I mentioned, like it contains some kind of metadata like for your operator, like the authors and etc. And probably if you will use like the operator hub platform, like to distribute their operators, this metadata will be displayed in the UI. So if you are familiar, for example, with the operator hub, or for example, you are familiar with the artifact hub, you saw that in your browser, you have a lot of details about the operators. Like all these details will be captured from this cluster service version document. Then it contains the installation section. So it describes how your operator, the controller for your operator must be installed. So it contains the set of the permissions, yeah, for your operator, but it contains the permissions and cluster permissions. So probably you know what is that. So the permissions, it's the namespace scope permission with the roles, and the cluster permission, it's a cluster-wide permissions based on the cluster role. So like when you will install with this cluster service version, then all the permissions will be created automatically. So you don't need to provide some additional resources and everything else, like a cluster role bindings and et cetera. So it's also will save your time. And the last subsection is deployment. So it contains all the options that will be included in your controller deployment, because you select this, for example, you have a strategy deployment, but probably you might select the strategy like a daemon set. So in that case, you will be able to describe, for example, you need to, I don't know, add some kind of additional memory or like mount some additional volumes or something like that. So you can include everything here and everything will be like presented after installation of your operator. And the last section, it's a custom resource definition. So it's also split for two subsections. One, it's the owned, and the second, the third one, like describes custom resource and custom resource definitions that you will like use in the scope of your operator. Like it means like all the custom resources that are provisioned by your operators and will be installed by your operators. And the required section, like it's what we discussed in the previous. Yeah, it has a list of the custom resource definitions. Yeah, that are probably managed by another operators, and like the OLM will check in like this required section and will take all the requirements. So it will install the required operators for your custom resources. So you probably you don't need to know which operator you need as a dependency for your operator. Yeah, you just need to know which kind of resources you need to use. And OLM will care about this, will find the appropriate operator that manage those resources, and we'll install it for you. So this is like the main document that you need to care about. And definitely this document particularly is a part of the configuration of the OLM. However, like it's backed during the operator like development process. So we cannot like split it. So and probably it it's related for both parts. The second resource is a catalog. So as I described, like you have your cluster service version, like your manifest, and you can build the catalog. So what actually the catalog? Catalog, it's a set of the cluster service version documents, but like you cannot just like create it in the cluster, yeah? Because like when you, you for example, if you need to redistribute it, so you need to provide some easy way how to do that, and how the like how it works in the scope of the OLM and actually in the scope of the operator framework. So you take your manifest like for the operator. So you take your all your cluster service version manifest, and then you bundle it to the catalog image. So the catalog image, it's a standard Docker image with some kind of specific format. Yeah, it's based on the operator framework image. Like it's a operator repository image. Yeah, and like everything that will be done, that like just all your cluster service versions will be just included to specific directory in this. In this image. So, and then you can share this image with the, for example, rest of the teams or to another organization, and all of them will have a set of your cluster service version manifest and will be able to install your operators. How it will be like provisioned for OLM? Because here you can see that there is some kind of like a specific custom resource to do that. So in this custom resource, you need to put the image that contains your catalog, like the display name that you will see in the console, and the name of the publisher, and the, like you can emit the source type. So here I just presented it just for case, yeah. The main option is the update strategy. So to understand what actually the update strategy, you need to understand how the catalog source work. Yeah, once you will create this catalog source resource, LM service and will deploy the pod like based on your image, and this pod will be like. With the provisioned Kubernetes service, yeah, and the OLM will just like across that service, it will examine your image and will take a list of the cluster service version documents in this image. So because it will be also run it as a service, as a REST API server. So probably you, after you created your catalog source, you will be able like to examine it with a CURL and to see the list of your cluster service version. Yeah, but for that purposes, there is some specific tool. And to understand why actually the update strategy is, it's the, it contains the interval, like how often your catalog will be updated. So for example, here is presented like 30 minutes. So it means that the OLM will pull this image every 30 minutes and will redeploy the pod with your catalog like every 30 minutes. For example, if your catalog, so you have, you probably might have a public catalog, like public images, and you might have the private catalogs. Like to pull the private catalogs, you need also to pass the secrets that contains the credentials for your like private Docker registry. So it's okay if you work in some kind of private organization, but just for case. So it's all possible parameters. So there are not, like there is no other parameters here. So once you created your catalog source, like for example, like you created the catalog source and you can get your catalog source and you can see like the main metadata fields from your catalog source. I'll show you how to like operate with these during our usage demo. The next resource is a subscription. So it's like probably the main resource that will be used by OLM. So what means by subscription and what actually the subscription document? So subscription document will point the OLM that specific version of the operator from specific catalog and specific channel of this catalog must be installed. Or probably like the specific version, because like there is ability to also add the versions. Yeah, it's an old screenshot. So in the newer version of this, I think it's Alpha 3, you have ability to install a specific version. Yeah, but the subscription will point the OLM like that specific operator must be automatically installed or probably manually installed. Like if you will add an install plan approval manual option. So there are two options, like two possible values here. It could be manual or it could be automatic. So by default, it's automatic, so you can omit the whole value. So it will point you, point the OLM that like the operator that is placed in the name option must be installed from the source. So it's point it to the catalog and source namespace. It's a namespace where your catalog is deployed because the catalog source resources are namespace based resources. So you need to point where actually the operator OLM, where it should look up for your catalog. So, and once you installed, like once you created the subscription, so the OLM will have a task to install specific operator. So it will examine the catalog serve, like your catalog service, yeah? Will check in if the catalog contains the cluster service version for the specific operator. Check in like if this operator are presented in some specific channel. So we will talk about the channels again in at the end of our call. Yeah, like it will look up for this channel and will check in it. And like if it's presented, it will install the latest version from it. Yeah, and for example, if you will like push the new version of your operator to the catalog, so the subscription will still be presented. So like according to this subscription and after the like publishing of the new version of your operator, yeah, the OLM will take the subscription, will upload the latest version of your manifest for your operator and will automatically install it. Like again, in case if you like put the install plan approval, so it won't install everything like automatically. So in this case, you will be need to approve it. And to approve it, you need to understand how the install plan resource work. So when you in your subscription, you configure it like the install plan like manual. So and once you have a new once you created your subscription or you published new version of your operator to the subscription, instead of the installation of your operator, the OLM will create the install plan resource. Yeah. in this install plan resource, it will contains like the one key that is called approved. So by default, it will be false. And it will contain the list of the cluster service version documents and versions that will be installed according to this install plan. So to continue the installation, you need to patch this resource and set the approved field to true. So because by default, it will be false. Yeah. Once you will change the install plan resource, so after that, the installation of your operator will be performed as you expected. And here I presented some kind of shortcuts. Yeah. For example, I created the subscription that has the install plan manual. Yeah. After that, I can just check the same namespace where my subscription is located, and I see that install plan was created and it contains the manual approval and it's not approved. So I can just take this name of the install plan, execute the shortcut command, like I will set the approved field to true, and like this resource will be patched. So the OLM will continue its own work with the base subscription for this install plan, and we'll install all the cluster service version documents to your cluster. And the last resource that we need to understand is the operator group. Yeah, to install the operators, operators to your cluster, you need to define to which namespaces your operator will be able to be installed. Yeah, because like for the default namespace, the OLM will prevent it just will omit the basic namespace and won't be able to install your cluster service version and install your operators to them, to the basic namespace. To allow the OLM install your operator to specific namespaces, you need to create the operator group resource. And in that resource, you need to describe all the namespaces where the installation of the operator will be possible. So we will go across the whole, for now you can feel some kind of mess about this because we have a lot of the resources, but I will show you the general flow, how this could be done and in which order you need to create all that resources. So no worries about that. Just for now, your main task just to understand what are the main purposes for each resource. So for example, you created the operator group and you put that. You can just select the specific name of the resources, yeah. Or for example, you can use the label selector and select the multiple namespaces, to do not write all the names. and let's leave the custom resources that will be operated with the OLM and understand what are the main components for the OLM. Because the OLM is presented, it consists from two operators and just one service. So it contains the OLM operator, catalog operator, and the package service. So the OLM operator and catalog operator are operators that are actually use the same operator pattern and also are built with the operator SDK. And they operate and manage all the resources that we reviewed on the previous slides. And I'll show you which service operate with which resources. So you don't need to worry about that. Just understand that the OLM has three services and two of them are operators, and you can configure those operators with the custom resources. The first one, it's the OLM operator. So it will how it actually work, it will the OLM operator watch for three resources. It will watch for the operator group, it will watch for the cluster service version, and it will watch for the install plan. So once your cluster service version resource will appear in the cluster, like the OLM will perform the installation of it. Like it will create the deployments, it will create the custom resource definitions, it will create the roles, bindings, cluster roles, and etc. And also it needs the operator group, because for the installation of the operator, it will check in the operator group resource to understand if the operator could be installed in like in some specific namespace. And also it will look to the installation plan, because the it checks if the installation plan is approved before like apply the cluster service version to your cluster. So just like be careful with that. So, and for example, if the installation plan is approved and the operator group has a namespace of like where you want to install your operator, and you have a cluster service version document that are presented in your cluster, after that, the OLM will just perform the installation of your operator according to the options in the cluster service version. And the second service, it's a catalog operator. What actually catalog operators do? So it looks for the catalog sources and perform also the update of the catalog source, like pulling of the new images with the catalog source and etc. It will look up for the subscription and it will also create the install plan. Probably here we might also add a cluster service version. Why? Because like when you created the catalog operator, like when you will create the subscription, and the catalog operator will check in that your install plan is approved, it will create the cluster service version document in your cluster. So it will pull the cluster service version document from the catalog source and it will just apply it to your cluster. So that's all dependencies. So the main flow, again, let's try to repeat. The main flow is the catalog source will create the images for will create the pods and services for the images that can according to the catalog source resources that you have in the cluster. It will take all the list of the cluster service version. After that, it will react for the subscriptions. Once it has a subscription, it will check in if the specific operators are presented in any catalog source. And once it's presented, so the catalog source will extract it from the catalog operator will extract it from the catalog source service. And according to the subscription, it will create the installation plan and will create the cluster service version from the pulled manifest in your cluster. And after that, let's back to the previous slide. Maybe I need to swap it in this presentation. And after that, the OLM operator, once the cluster service version resource will appear in your cluster, it will install the operator. But the install plan must be approved and the operator group must include the target namespace where you want to install your operator. So this process definitely is automated. So you just to operate with all that things, you just need to do a few actions. And the last service, so it's not the operator itself, it just provides you the ability, how you can get the list of all the operators that are presented in the catalog sources in your cluster. So it's just for the, it creates a cache of the operators that are presented in all your catalogs, and you can just get it from here and understand which versions are presented and etc. So it's just for your internal usage. It's some kind of useful service. Okay, now let's before we will talk about the final workflow. It's a part. Let's review the part that I mentioned a lot of time. It's the operators upgrade strategies. So probably, as you know, all the main idea of splitting of the operators by channels, like what it means, like it means that all your operator distributions, like by distribution just means the cluster service version. Yeah, so the cluster service version document, it's the document that contains the description and instructions for specific version of your operator. Yeah. And you can also include it to some specific channel in your catalog. Yeah, for example, the standard names are alpha, beta, and stable. It's the common known names. But you like are free because there is no limitation for that. You can use, for example, I don't know, dev, stage, and prod. So, and this mechanism, for example, if you use the OLM for your like for your ecosystem, and like you want to, you have the same catalogs for the production and for the development. And for example, you want, for example, in the development, you want to include all intermediate versions. Yeah. So in that case, you will include everything, like all the versions in the alpha channel. Yeah. For example, the stage will contain just like the pre-release candidates, and the stable like will contain just the stable versions. Why we need also this approach? Because like the OLM will install the operators one by one. What does it mean? For example, if you it will upgrade the operators one by one. For example, you have the operator, for example, 061, yeah, and you want to upgrade it to the 092. So it will look up for all the operators in your catalog that will be between those versions and will install it one by one, once it will achieve the target versions. However, like you in your cluster service version document, you can describe like the main workflow, how this could be done. For example, in the cluster service version document for the like version point 0.9.0, you can write that it replaces the version 0.6.1. And the OLM will take this instruction and will understand that it doesn't need to install all the intermediate versions, and the 0.9.0 is good, and like it will be install it like without installation of the intermediate versions. However, like in this case, for example, if you want to upgrade to 0.9.2 from version like 0.6.1, so and you configure the replacement, so it will install the version 0.9.0. After that, it will install 0.9.1, and after that, it will install 0.9.2. So you need to understand how you want, how you like will build your like upgrade flow, and which intermediate versions of your operator you need for the upgrade to keep the backward compatibility. So for example, let's imagine that your alpha channel will be used in your dev environment. So once you have some kind of pre-release candidate, you can include this cluster service version document, like version, to the beta channel. Yeah, and also we'll configure the replacement. For example, like that you understood that you can easily upgrade from the version 0.6.1 to 0.9.2 without like intermediate versions, so no worries about that. So just like include the beta channel, configure the replacement, and the OLM will care about this, and like it will know that like to install the like to make this upgrade step, it doesn't need the intermediate versions. So it's a very very smart way. And for example, here you can like, here's presented how you can, for example, include the one version of your like operator, like one version of your cluster service version. Again, you can include it to the like two different channels. Yeah, so in the same time, yeah, to do not duplicate it, because like all of that documents will be presented in your catalogs twice. So you can just select one of them. So, and according to that, yeah, for example, let's imagine that here we also have a stable. You can build not just the like upgrade in the perspective of the one channel. Yeah, you can build the whole graph of the versions that will be need for the upgrade, like for all three channels. Yeah, and for example, like if you have for example here the like intermediate version like 0.6.1, yeah, and you have it in a stable. So, and for example, you can include the version 0.9.2 in the alpha, beta, and stable. And in a stable, you will have also the same mechanism, like from the stable channel, all your operator that will be installed by subscription from the stable channel will like use this version from any channel, yeah? And also the same, like if this will be included to the multiple channels, it will take any of it from any channel, yeah. But if you will have the specific version, a specific channel, and it wasn't presented in another channel, so you probably might have a problems. And the OLM the OLM has the mechanism to roll it out. And also why this upgrade, like one by one, why it's needed, like because the OLM will be able to roll out to the latest, to the last successful version. And for example, if you have the deep inside in your deep inside component, you can configure the OLM in such way, like also to check in how your deployment of your operator works. If it's fine, then continue to upgrade. If it's not fine, then like stop to upgrade and roll out to the previous version. So this like will give you a better ability for the failure prevention. And how you can like write in your cluster, how you can actually write, yeah, like decide how your operator must be upgraded and what it actually replaces. Yeah, for example, you have a version like 0.9.2. Yeah, you need to write here that it replaces the previous version, like 0.9.0. And optionally, you can write add the skip options. Yeah, like to skip intermediate versions. Yeah. For example, if you install like here, if you install the version 0.9.2, yeah, you want to upgrade to it, so it will upgrade from the version 0.9.0, but will omit the 0.9.1. So this version will be omitted, and like it's totally fine. For example, if you have a beta channel, to do not include the intermediate versions. Yeah, so we will just write the replaces and you and that's all. However, like if the intermediate versions are also not presented in your catalog, it also will be totally fine. So you don't need to worry about that if you configure the replaces and skips in the appropriate way. Okay, final workflow. So here we are. So how to use all that things and all these possibilities? The first step is like building of your operator. For example, you created the operator with SDK, configured the API, write your reconcile logic, and etc. Yeah. After that, you need to generate the bundle of your operator. What actually the bundle? Bundle contains the cluster service version manifest, like your operator manifest, and it contains the manifest for the custom resource definitions that will be managed by your operator, and also some kind of additional annotations. However, like it will be presented as a simple catalog in your system. Yeah. Once you have your bundle, you can include your bundle to the catalog. So for example, you can create the catalog from scratch, add the folder with your bundle to the catalog, and make the render of your catalog. So the result that you will have, it's the image. Yeah? And after that, once you have the image, you can create the cluster catalog source resource in the cluster that has OLM, yeah, and point it to that image. So, and the OLM in your cluster will pull that image and will prepare all the operators in that catalog for the installation. And then you will be able to use the subscription. Before you will install, just also create the group, like operator group, like to give the ability for OLM, use some kind of specific namespaces to install the operators. The second step after that, it's a almost final step. It's a creation of your subscription. Yeah, you created the subscription for some specific channel and some specific catalog for a specific operator. And that's all. And if the operator lifecycle manager, according to that subscription, will take the cluster service version document and will create it in the cluster. And again, after it will be created in the cluster, again, the OLM operator component, OLM operator component of the OLM, yeah, sorry for that. It will like deploy your operator from that cluster service version. Probably you might have one additional step with approval. If you configure the install plan creation, yeah, like install approval in your subscription, then you also will be need to approve. So for example, if you have two environments, like you have a dev and stage, dev and prod, yeah. In the dev, you can create a subscription with the like automatic installation. Yeah, once, for example, like your CI system prepare it, like build the operator, create the catalog, and publish that catalog to some Docker registry, yeah, image with your catalog. So once your catalog will be updated automatically, like OLM, according to the subscription, will perform the upgrade process for you. But for the production environment, you can use the approval mechanism. And for example, the new catalog will be presented in the registry. Yeah, it will contain the alpha, beta, and stable channel. And for your production, you use the stable channel. And the OLM looks that for the stable channel, it has the upgrade for the version. So it will create a like approval. And once you will approve it, the version of your operator for your it will be installed. So this process, like this, will give you ability to implement release and also delivery strategy. So and like definitely it will like speed up the development and like mostly delivery processes. Yeah, and will automate it. It will add the mechanism of the automatic rollouts, and the easy versioning, set of your services. Because probably you might have like two services, and you might have 500 services that you need to manage. So this will save your time. And that's all about the final workflow. A couple of details before we start the usage demo. So the operator lifecycle manager, it's not the like some kind of private or enterprise tool. It's the open source tool like that are provisioned in the scope of the operator framework. So it's supported by the community. And definitely it's recommended to be used in the production environments. And for example, if you will take a look on the OpenShift platform again, so it used the OLM to install all the applications. And the main paradigm of the OpenShift that everything should be like prepared and installed as the operators, and like the operators must be managed and provisioned with the OLM and etc. So it's not so young project. So, and definitely it's ready for the production usage. And the last thing that I want to point you, it's the operator hub. So the operator hub IO, it's the public portal where the community authors could publish their operators. And probably, like, for example, you need to publish your operator to, you want to publish your operator for the community or as an open source solution. You can use the operator hub for that. Or for example, you need some dependencies for your application, right? For example, I don't know, database or I don't know, the cache server like Redis. So you can find everything here, yeah? And by default, when you install the OLM, it will provide the catalog source for the operator hub. So everything that is present, like that is presented in the operator hub IO could be already installed by the OLM when you will create, just to create the subscription. It's what we will actually do during our live demo. And I think that's all from the theoretical part. So we will move to the usage demo. Okay. Please ping me if you can see my Visual Studio code. Just let me know.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So to do not waste like your time and like speed up the our call, yeah, and leave just the useful stuff. So I already created the cluster on my machine with Minikube, and also I installed the OLM with the Operator SDK. So probably I have here, yeah, I have even the comment in my history about that. Let's run the dashboard because I can do everything from the console, but for the better visualization, let's look in the dashboard. But don't do that on your production system in such way. So I installed the OLM. Like OLM will be installed in to the OLM namespace. Also, it will create the operator's namespace that by default it will be also provisioned with the operator group resources. So by default, the OLM has at least one namespace where it can install the operators. One more important thing, like the operator group resource, like it's a very, very important. It's a namespace scope resource. And you cannot have them multiple operator group resources in the same namespace. If you will have the, like, you need to have the one operator group resource per namespace. If you will have more, then OLM will throw the error. So it's described in the documentation. So just like the basic approach that like probably you might want to do, like if you want to use the specific namespaces, so just create the namespace and create the operator group in that namespace related, like that will point to that namespace. Or probably if you want to include all namespaces like by the label, so just like create the operator group in the OLM namespace that will include the set of all the namespaces. So probably it also will work fine. If you will go to the Operator Lifecycle Manager to OLM namespace, we can see that we have a couple of the deployments. Let's take a look on the pods that we have here. So as I mentioned, we have the OLM operator pod, yeah, that will look up for the configuration that we will create. It has a catalog operator, and it has two instances of the package service that will look up for all the operators, yeah, and according to that, it will create a list of all possible versions that could be installed from that catalog. And again, as I promised, that we have the operator hub IO catalog. So as I mentioned, yeah, we have a catalog source, and here you can see it is a label. You have a catalog source, yeah. And when you created this catalog source, the pod will be created, and probably we have a service for that. Let me take a look. Yep, here is the service. Yeah, so the OLM will use that service to point to that image and to grab all possible cluster service version manifests. Okay, I think we are good with the upwards here. Okay, so let's take a look which actually which packages are like we can have in our which packages we can have in we can install with the OLM. So let's take a look of the for this list, and you can see that like the community catalog, actually it's an operator hub catalog. It contains a lot of different operators. Yeah. So in that case, I won't create the like a custom catalogs or etc. So it's pretty straightforward process. You can open up the documentation and understand how to build your own catalog. It's not something interesting. It's a routine task that probably must be automated. So and here I can see the list of the operators that are available. Let's take a look. Like that, I want, for example, install some kind of application. I'll go to the operator hub and you'll choose the application that I want to install. For example, I want to install the etcd. Yeah, so I'll just take a look for the etcd. Okay, so here is it, and it's provisioned by Cloud Native Compute Foundation. So it's the authors of the Kubernetes stuff. And as I showed you, like the guys that like provisioned some kind of additional metadata in their operator manifest, and it's like demonstrated here, and also all the custom resource definitions are presented here, so you can see which custom resource definitions will be created by your operator and how it will be like managed. So here I have, for example, the etcd cluster. Yeah, so I can select the version of the etcd, and I can select a number of nodes that I want to use. Probably I might add additional options here. Yeah, but to do that, you just need to look for the cluster to the custom resource definition and understand like which, what are the possible values could be here. So we have the install button here. So what it actually like allows you to do, like it asks you to install the Operator Lifecycle Manager. Yeah, and it says that you can just take and install the etcd the cluster service version. Yeah, so it will point you to the latest one from this channel. So it's one important thing that you can create everything without the subscription. Yeah, you can just create the cluster service version document, like apply it to your cluster, and the OLM will install everything. However, like I promised you that I will show you how to automate this process, like automate the process of the upgrade. So I demonstrated the example with the subscriptions. So once you will install the etcd component, so like etcd cluster service version, definitely it will be created here. And once you will create the custom resource definitions for this operator, like it will be also realized by this operator. So what I actually prepared here, I prepared the operator group. Yeah. So I want to have the, like for example, I want to use the default namespace. So I'll create the operator group in my default namespace and will point to the same default namespace. So I'll just take it and apply it. Let me go to the OLM folder. -f-og-yaml. Oh, okay, it's created. So now my namespace could be like operated by the OLM. Now what I want to do, I want to install like the subscription. So let's take a look here. So the operator will be installed to the same namespace where your subscription is located. And to allow this, you need to have like the operator group already created there. So what I want to do, I want to take etcd operator, want to take it with the single namespace alpha channel. So here is present all the channels. So to understand which channel is related for, just take a look for the detailed documentation here. I think it's described somewhere there. Once you will do that, so what I actually want to do, I have the already installed catalog source, like with community operators. It's located in the OLM namespace, and also I want to perform the manual approval. So I just want to understand how to work with the installation plan. So let me create the apply minus F subscription. Okie dokie. Apply, right typos. Okay, so I created the subscription, and probably the OLM should create the install plan for me. So let's try to look for that. Yeah, so here is it. I have the installation plan that will point that the etcd version 0.9.4 will be installed, and I need to approve it. So the names of the install plan, it's automatically generated, so be careful with that. So I'll just patch this resource. Okay, so and this plan is approved. So and definitely in my default namespace, here is it. So somewhere here, I like once everything will be done, I'll have my operator. So this might take some time. Let's take a look, like in the meantime, let's take a look what I actually want to create. As I showed you that I want to create the etcd cluster, so I can take a look here. So I can see like that I want to create the specific version of my etcd cluster. So what I actually just need to do to create the etcd cluster, just apply it and my operator will perform all the changes here. Yeah, so probably this might take some time because I have a slow internet connection. Let's take a look. So here is presented missing. Yeah, so this might take some time. Okay, I have the image. So it's pulling the image and etc. And it contains a lot of them. Mm-hmm. Let's take a look on the custom resource definitions here. So I have a cluster service version here, and I have no objects here yet because like under the update. Okie dokie, what happens here? Okay. So probably this might be some kind of job that will pull the catalog image for me or not. No, it will pull them in the OLM from here. This might take some time. Just for case, let's create the etcd stuff here. So once the operator will be created, just a sec. Okay, so the operator is not installed, so I cannot create the custom resources yet. My bad. Okay. Yeah, that looks pretty weird. Usually it tries to update something during my session, during my sessions or my demonstration of this feature. Okay, let's take a look what it says. So here I don't have any kind of, so here in this probably like ideally in this namespace, I need, I must have the cluster service version for my etcd operator. Yeah. And also here I must have the subscription for that stuff. And here is it. Here the operator group is presented that I mentioned. Okay. Okay, here is it, 5 minutes. I just can't imagine like what is the size of this image. Let's try to refresh. Okay, something happened. So let's try to check in if I have my, okay, so I have my operator here that it's installed and I have probably the cluster service version. Yeah, as I mentioned for my etcd. So the cluster service version was pulled from the catalog. And it was created in my cluster. And the OLM took this cluster service version. Yeah, so we can take a look on this. And created all the custom resource definitions for this operator. So I have etcd backup, etcd cluster, etcd restore. Yeah. And it's created the operator for that purposes. Probably created because it will also pull the image, and with my slow internet connection, it will take some time. Let's wait to look up if it's possible or not. Okay, I think we can create here the etcd stuff because like we already have the items that are presented, like the custom resource definitions that are presented and are related to the etcd operator. So, and probably once the operator will start, after that, like it will, like install our etcd stuff. And definitely we will see that. Okay, let's wait. In the meantime, maybe you have any questions? Okay, probably I have questions in the... Okay. It might put also a couple of pieces, something like that. But probably, like, one more important thing when you like develop your operator, use some kind of Alpine images or something like that. Like, because like if you will use the huge images, then like you will have a lot of problems and your deployment probably might be slow, even on the like systems that has the slow internet connections. Okay. I can understand how many. I don't know, but it's very slow. Okay, so I'm not sure how many time it will take, and probably I don't want to waste your time, but you understand the main idea of the OLM, yeah? So you created, like, you can create some kind, you need to install the OLM, then you need to add some additional resources that will configure the OLM, and according to that resources, it will create and deploy your operator. And once you will create your operator, you will be able to use the custom resource definitions that are managed by your operator, like to install and operate with your resources. Probably we missed not so important part because like it's a full demo, yeah, but the main part with the OLM and installation of the operator, it was demonstrated, so like, probably you don't miss anything interesting. I think that all from my side. What I will do, I'll share the presentation and also I'll share this package for the usage demo. So you will be able to like try it by yourself or play with it. I think that's all from my side. So probably maybe somebody has any questions, concerns, or something like that.
No questions.
Okay. Yeah, but probably if you might have any questions, just let me know. So like, write to me directly. So like, it's totally fine. Okay. In that case.
Okay.
Thank you for your attention and thank you for your patience.
Yes, thank you, Eldar, for your performance, judging from the comments, as I'm not tech expert. The topic was really interesting, so thank you very much for sharing all your experience with us. Thank you all for attending our event. Hope to see you on our next events, and of course, all materials will be shared with you. Wishing you a great Friday and weekend ahead. Bye-bye.
Thanks a lot. See you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.